Penguin Audio presents Bend, Not Break, A Life in Two Worlds by Ping Fu. Read by Robin Miles. 1. Three Friends of Winter. Fresh off the plane, 1984. When I was 25 years old, the Chinese government quietly deported me. I was terrified to leave my homeland, but the alternative was exile to a remote place in China, or worse. On January 14, 1984, my parents, aunts and uncles, cousins and siblings gathered at the Shanghai International Airport to send me off for my flight to San Francisco. I'll never forget that cold, wet afternoon. As the embarking process began, my family stood in a tight circle outside the passport checkpoint, shuffling our feet and avoiding eye contact. We made small talk about the weather, the clothes we wore, and the farewell banquet they had hosted the night before. Anything to distract us from our imminent parting. Hesitating for a moment before she spoke, my Shanghai mama, the woman who raised me, broached the subject on everyone's mind. "Ping Ping," she said, her tongue tripping as she called me by my family nickname. "I made you a dish so you won't get hungry on the long flight." Her whole body trembled as she reached into her bag and passed me a round tin pan, tightly covered in foil, still warm. I lifted a corner of the foil and inhaled. The sharp, sweet scent of duck with soy sauce wafted up to my nostrils, a poignant reminder of my happy childhood years in Shanghai. I reached my hand out to clasp hers, giving it a gentle squeeze. I glanced around. Nearly everyone in our group was crying. My younger sister Hong grabbed at my shirt to mop the tears from her face, the way she had done as a little girl. I couldn't bring myself to utter any words of comfort for fear that I too would break down sobbing. Only Nanjing mother and father, my birth parents, kept their gaze steady. "You will be fine, Ping Ping," Nanjing mother said, clearing her throat. "I know you will be able to handle whatever comes your way." I waited until the last possible minute to go. "It's time," I said, making an effort to keep my voice from catching. My family members began to cry the way people do at funerals, as if I would disappear from their lives forever. They knew that since I was in trouble with the authorities, we might never see one another again, or even be allowed to communicate. Resolutely, I kept my eyes dry as I walked down the ramp and away from everything that I had ever known. As I settled into my seat aboard the aircraft, the vent blasted warm air at my forehead. It occurred to me that this was my first experience of temperature-controlled air. I had never flown in an airplane, though I had spent most of my childhood sliding down aircraft wings at an abandoned airfield and dreaming of becoming an astronaut. I had never traveled anywhere outside of China. The farthest I had been from Nanjing, the city of my birth, was Suzhou University, where I had studied journalism and literature. But that was not why I felt apprehensive about the journey that lay ahead. Because of my writing and other activities, I was no longer welcome in my homeland. Yet I knew little about America. I had no home, no friends, and no sense of what awaited me there. I didn't have a single spare dollar in my pocket or speak more than three words of English. When we were airborne, the flight attendant came by, wheeling a cart. She was an American with blonde hair, blue eyes, and a warm smile. In English, she asked me if I wanted something to eat or drink. I didn't understand her since I knew how to say only hello, thank you, and help. But I guessed at her intention. I presumed that the refreshments would cost money, so I waved my hand in a gesture that said no, hugging Shanghai Mama's tin pan even tighter on my lap. Then I pointed toward the cocktail napkins piled high at the edge of the cart, and the stewardess wordlessly handed me a large stack. For hours, I scribbled Chinese characters onto the thin squares of paper, placing one after another at the corner of my tray, like miniature flags of surrender. I did not intend to share these notes, Journaling had proved comforting to me since I was a child. The act of recording my thoughts gave the illusion of having a conversation with a trusted friend, when in truth I now had none. I landed in San Francisco 14 hours later, jet-lagged and emotionally drained. The airport amazed me. It glittered like a jewel with its multiple-story tall windows and sparkling cleanliness. As soon as I had cleared immigration, I sought out the ticket counter. I was en route to Albuquerque, where I was registered to study English as a second language at the University of New Mexico. Although I had exactly $80 in traveler's checks to pay for the connecting flight, the airline staff refused to issue me a ticket. I couldn't understand why. That had been the price when I had checked in Shanghai. Bless San Francisco. There was a Mandarin-speaking agent behind the counter who understood my problem. In China, the government sets prices, so ticket prices rarely changed. But here in America, prices changed frequently, she explained. The ticket price has increased since you left Shanghai. You are $5 short. I didn't have $5, a credit card, or a number to call for help. As I stood there silently, an American man waiting behind me in line asked us what the problem was. When the desk agent explained my predicament, he took a $5 bill out of his wallet. "Here you go," he said, flashing an easy smile. The ticket agent translated. "Thank you," I replied in English, surprised that a stranger would help me. The gesture may not have meant much to him, but it meant the world to me. My first impression of Americans, and one that endures to this day, was that they are warm, giving people. The experience offered me this life lesson: when in doubt, always err on the side of generosity. It is a value that I've held dear to my heart ever since. When I got to Albuquerque, I found myself stranded once again. My father had given me the name of Mr. Sheng, a former student of his who was studying at the University of New Mexico, and had helped my family to get me accepted there. I called him collect several times, but the phone rang endlessly. I waited, hoping eventually I'd reach this stranger who was my only U.S. contact. I had nowhere else to turn. Later, I learned that Mr. Sheng had graduated from UNM a few weeks before I arrived and was touring America before returning to China. As I sat on the curb outside the luggage claim with my one large, tattered bag, I watched the cars coming and going. The popping sound of car trunks opening unnerved me. No one seemed to notice me. They were all too busy leaving the airport or coming here to pick up their loved ones. It reminded me of the day when I was 8 years old that I left Shanghai by train and arrived at the Nanjing station alone. The feelings of loss hit me hard, and I began to cry. A car pulled up in front of me some time later. When I looked up with hazy eyes, I saw a Chinese man sitting in the driver's seat. He rolled down the window slowly. "Do you need help?" the man asked, speaking in Mandarin, with a thick accent that I couldn't place. "Yes," I said. "I needed a ride to the University of New Mexico campus." "Get in," he said, waving his hand toward the passenger seat. "I'll take you there." Another generous American. And not only that, there were Chinese-speaking people everywhere here. I couldn't believe my luck. We drove off in his beat-up car across a vast and desolate desert plain that resembled a post-apocalyptic landscape. My limited impressions of America had come entirely from Chinese state-run television, which I had watched from time to time, huddled in groups with my classmates and neighbors around someone's black-and-white TV. Mostly, I knew that the Chinese dominated the Americans in ping-pong. Still, I had expected to be living in a city like the dense metropolises of Nanjing and Shanghai where I had grown up, not a place like this. "Do you mind if we stop by my house?" the man asked. "I need to check in on my kids before I can drop you off at the university." I nodded. A few minutes later, We drove into the Albuquerque Center City.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.